full stop in the wow is the practice. That is the practice. There isn't some other practice here. So we're walking together in the wow. This is the way to describe what this is. Walking together in the wow. That doesn't change. I'm experiencing a tremendous wow this morning. So I'm talking the talk and walking the walk. As I'm not in some ivory tower, sterile, intellectual, spiritually intellectual ivory tower, conceptualizing something. I'm experiencing the wow. Very intense. Now, this is the only discipline there is. It's simple. It's simple. We don't have a very complex path at all. Very simple. This is what works because truth is entirely simple, entirely non-subtle, actually. It's present. It is. And seeing this, glimpsing this, we just say, wow. That's prior to all our complex conceptual engagements with truth, with reality. When we don't recognize the wow, then we go on to these more complex conceptual engagements, which torture us, and we just spin our wheels. So this morning, the presence of the one true self, I glimpsed it. It became aware of it, and then I said, "Okay, wow, what do I do?" I just say, "Okay, wow." Very casually, I just decide, okay, I'm not going to try and grasp it. I'm just going to now turn to the wow of this experience. And very calm, very quiet. There hasn't been struggle or effort involved. Other than the only effort we have is this discipline of recognizing the wow and saying, all that I need is just to stay with this wow, because this is prior to all this dualistic engagement, attempting to engage with isness, attempting to align with it, attempting anything at all in relation to isness. The wow is saying is sort of like a neither nor. Well, wow, I'm neither engaged with it nor am I not engaged with it in terms of conceptuality. And neither nor is a conceptual position. I neither have a conceptual position nor do I not have a conceptual position. It's the final conceptual position, but it's without struggle, it without elaboration. Okay, it's the non-elaborated final concept of just wow. It's a mixture of elation and trepidation. Also, it's so we just stop right there. We don't go attempting to elaborate upon the wow. We say, oh no, I need more elaboration. No, we don't need any more elaboration. We've already seen that. We see the truth. We recognize it. We recognize this is. And it's the recognition and the response to this the wow. We don't need to elaborate it on it very much at all. I can do chit-chat and then we flip this work on flipping the script back to recognizing isness again, accepting that this is what is acceptance of that. There's no time, there's no progress towards it, there's no progression towards it. All of this existence is a presumption. It's a presumption of scam. It's an attempt to scam God, plain and simple. All of existence is this attempt to scam what is, and saying that it isn't yet, or it's on its way to becoming, to not being, that being is on the way to not being, and that there's a new will, there's a presumption that we're going to learn how to, a new will is learnable. A separate will, a new will, is learnable. So the goal of this presumptive dream wishful thinking that we call existence is that we believe we can learn. It's learning. Now, Jesus told us that the goal of his curriculum, the true curriculum of truth, the one that he is pointing out to us and saying, this is the universal, it is a universally true curriculum. Styles may differ, but the truth is, it's unlearning. It's not learning, it's unlearning. It's setting aside learning, set aside the goal of learning. So when we're just on the wow, we're not learning. Okay, this is important. And the ego, you know, the objective of learning, which we say, well, we got to learn how to, you know, be have a separate will, otherwise we won't have any will at all, which is, you know, a lie. It's made up presumption. If we just full stop in the wow, there's no learning taking place. There's just this familiarity taking place, and evaporating the continuity fear. Just let the continuity fear evaporate around abidance as the isness, which means that there's not a presumption, a presuming, a pre-assumption that it needs to be something other than what it is. There's some need. We don't. Reality has no needs. We don't have any needs. We're not needy. Especially, we don't need to be helped. Now, this is what I got into this morning, and I asked the Holy Spirit for help, you might say, and the Holy Spirit, okay, here's the real help. And I was shown that the only help we need is a temporary pragmatic help with our continuity issue, and we need help to realize we don't need any help. And so all of this came clear to me, that the world said, and what happened was I began to recognize how I used to feel when I was like, you know, 10, 11 years old or something like that. It was young. And everyone said, we need to help you. We're here to be helpful. I said, I don't want your help. I don't need your help. And I found that everyone here was trying to interfere with the beingness, and they called that being helpful. And so I put up a great battle against all this helpfulness, and people thought I was very selfish. You're selfish. You won't let us help you. Help you. Help me do what? Help me with what? I don't need any help. Reality doesn't need any help. There's only reality. Reality doesn't need any help. So this became very clear, and then I became aware of the presence of that which doesn't need any help. We cannot be aware of what we are as long as we think we need help. Other than the final illusion of help, which is help to recognize we don't need any help. Now, if you can listen to this, anyone who can listen to this and just feel like, wow, then you have, you know, stay with it. Stay with it, because this is a genuine Yani, you know, a genuine realizer. If there isn't a struggle that arises by saying, well, we need help, and recognizing we don't need any help, if that just settles in and says, ah, yes, then just feel the wow around that, because this means that the abidance in the self is quite imminent, you know, quite imminent. I don't necessarily going to be today or tomorrow or whatever. But it's imminent, and it's going to happen. I mean, it's something that is unavoidable when we're able to accept that the only help we need is to accept, realize and accept we don't need any help whatsoever. We have no needs whatsoever. If we have no needs, why do we need to be helped? We don't even have the need to be helped at all. The idea of help is we're trying to help one another develop a separate will, learn how to do the impossible. That's all this help, where this helpfulness comes. What we are, what is, doesn't need any help at all. It doesn't need to be become different than what it is? Does it need to change what it is? So, in being able to accept this, the only help we need is to accept that we don't need any help. This brings us very close to acceptance. You see, this brings this wow, like, wow, it's that simple. The wow is the recognition of how simple it is, how easy it is. It's so easy, I don't need any help at all, except help in recognizing I don't need any help. Helping to, you know, accept this. That's it. That's the final illusion of help. That's it. Nothing more than that. So this brings about the feeling of immediacy, like, oh my gosh, it's close, so close. And then the wow, it's a big wow. It's a huge wow. So in seeing this today, it was just a huge wow. I thought maybe I had used up all, there wasn't any more wows, and I still was not, you know, abiding. I said, oh gosh, what, you know what, this could be bad. But I said, well, let's not panic here. Let's just assume the wow is what's taking place. And then don't struggle conceptually with anything. Just go back to the wow. Remember, this is pre-elaboration, conceptual elaboration. Prior to conceptual elaboration, there's this wow feeling. Now, the wow feeling can go either way. That's why I say full stop in the wow. It can be a wow towards, wow, I'm going to elaborate, or wow, I don't need to elaborate. You see, when we tried to change what we are, there was a huge wow. And now, so we're going back to that huge wow, and we're allowing the continuity fear to evaporate around even dropping the wow. But we cannot ideologically drop the wow. Ideology is subsequent to the wow. Okay, it's you might say it's on a different level, so to speak, of it's on a level of elaboration. So it has no power to drop the wow. Only abiding in the wow, full stop in the wow, is what ultimately enables us then to then just simply abide as we are, as isness, the isness that is. That is not presumed to be something other than what it is. It's not presumed to be in any process. There's no presumption necessary. There's no presumption necessary. So, when we feel we're stuck, go back to the wow. And then, abiding in the wow becomes very easy to get a sense, get close to this, get a glimpse of the isness. Because when we decided we wanted to try and trick God, scam God, change, get a different will and be greater than God, the reaction was this, wow. Is this doable? I mean, wow. The first thing was, wow. Really? You know, I'm this audacious? And then we started, the wow kind of shook us up. I said, what do I do about the wow? And we start then elaborating upon it. The self, the reality is not needy. It doesn't need anything at all. It's free. Now, so, abiding in this wow, full stop in the wow, is the discipline. This is the discipline. This is the practice. The rest comes easy. So I already saw all about helpfulness and how we don't need any help at all. Say, Holy Spirit, save me from all helpfulness. Absolutely. Helpfulness is a presumption that what we are needs help. It is the presumption. A core root presumption. And so seeing this, I recognize this is very core. Very core. And then the presence of this The self, it's called the self, the one self, the isness, the self of isness. I became aware of that, just, you know, sort of peripherally. I said, okay, that's fine. Just let it be. I'm not going to try and struggle with that. I recognize there's a wow around this helpfulness. I recognize seeing this help, that I don't need any help, is what opened my awareness to what I am. So I see the causation there, right? The connection. So I already know there's a connection there. So I don't need to struggle with that. I already experienced the connection. I already experienced the clarity, the connection, the recognition. So there's no need to struggle. It's only a matter of being this sort of casual familiarity, allowing this familiarity to set in. Not a forced casuality. But as the familiarity sets in, you feel more confident around in this area, in this closeness. And there's no way to do it except to actually go into this wow, feel it, experience it, and abide in it. This is how we do it. I took a trip, just got back from a trip, a working vacation, so to speak, very strenuous, and it was very, very amazing, magnificent, actually. And I'm getting used to being in this place and getting familiar. I've just had a function there, you know. What's the mood? How do you function? What's the overall? It's just a comfort level. I know how to function there. Let's put it that way. But there isn't any way to learn this except to go there and experience it. And it's just you talk with people, you know, you get used to their way of communicating, you get used to the pace of life, you get used to all sorts of parameters, overall familiarity. Okay, this is the weather, this is the routine, this is how stuff works. I just walked around, moved around, just allowing myself to just get used to it. Same thing with the wow, you get used to it. There isn't any way. It's like I tell people, I say, well, how was the trip? And I say, well, you should go. And so we'll explain it to them. You can't. You cannot explain the overall familiarity with just the overall ambience and routine. You have to challenge oneself. It has to be you challenged to go there and do it. Went out on a golf course. I challenged myself. I got to go out. I got to do it. Boy, it was rough. I struggled. You know, had someone there helping me out. There was someone, you know, got paired with someone, and you know that was helpful. The next day, I went out again by myself, and it was easier. I got used to it. I asked questions. Can I come in at this point? And it should be, oh, don't worry. You know, and the marshal is there. What are they like? Is there a pressure to play at a certain pace? Is there this? Or there's that? There's all these different things, and you just say, okay, this is how they do things here, and I'm aware of how they do things here. This is how it is here, and I'm aware of it, so I can just go with the flow. Okay, there's a lake here, you know, this is the landscape, and the bighorn sheep, you know, there's a bighorn sheep there. Had a close encounter with bighorn sheep, and they're not dangerous. Okay, so now I know, okay, this is what they look like, this is how they act, they're not dangerous, this is what. And so I had experiences after experiences after experiences of the area, which clues you in to this is the area, these are the experiences that you have, this is the way people are. Will they bother you here? Will they look, you know, you say, who are you? Or are they welcoming you? Could you go here and just hang out? You know, what's the attitude and everything? So experiencing all this firsthand, I know, I have a familiarity. This is the attitude there. So I say, I can go back there. I could go back. It's not a problem. This is just how it is here. And it's no different on the spiritual path, actually. So it's very important not to take a crystallized, fixated, ideological stance, a conceptually ideological stance. What we're going here is an experiential process of familiarity and evaporating. Let the continuity fear evaporate. When you go to a new place, you're not sure what to expect. The more you get comfortable with the area, I've done this, I've done this, I've done this, I've done this. You talk to people and say, oh, they realize, hey, you know your way around here. Good, that's great. And you can handle yourself, that's good. And you know, just a gradual acculturation sort of takes place. Well, on the spiritual path, there's this gradual acculturation that takes place. And the statement of the realization that, you know, those who claim that, well, spiritual practice isn't necessary because, well, it's conceptual, so no need to do it, you know, or that's foolish. That's a crystallized ideological, intellectual, ideological position, and that's what happens is then that demands that everybody else adjust to, you know, what you want. It's like going taking a trip somewhere and demanding that everybody fit into your culture where you come from, you know, instead of you adjusting to this place. You insist the place adjusts to you, and you become very overbearing and dominating, trying to dominate everything, over instead of being, you know, gentle and humble and going with the flow and just fitting in. So this wow practice helps us get out of this ideological tower that we're imprisoned in. Reality doesn't need our ideology. And we don't need the ideology. Reality has no ideology. So we don't have a need to be ideological, actually. Ideological. Elaborating logic upon ideas. We merely experience all ideas. Now, the working vacation, there's a purpose to it. And we were treated there magnificently. I would say, you'd have to say, the term flawless could be at least referenced, not as an absolute, but it wouldn't be out of place either. The hospitality that we experienced there was magnificent and flawless. The trust, the hospitality of we trust our guests. We trust our guests. And nobody's looking over their shoulder at all at you. Nobody. You're simply free to do whatever you want to do. Nobody's saying, what are they doing? Why, who are they? Why are they here? You know, there's no sense of looking, you know, that anyone's looking over their shoulder at you. None at all. This is extraordinary experience in this world. So, the Holy Spirit has graced me with understanding of where to go to experience this, because this is very similar. This is a stepping stone, as it were, to a higher realm, which we may very well find ourselves in quite soon. The beauty, the natural beauty, the quiet, the peace, the hospitality. I say this is must be like what, you know, the death-free realm is like. You people call it heaven, paradise, whatever. It's just the, you know, you're an honored, esteemed guest. of wisdom. You know your own life. We don't have to tell you what to do. This is, you know, a rare experience in this world. Nobody telling you what to do. They trusted in you. They trust that you can guide your own life. You know what to do. If you want to do something, then do it. If you don't, then don't. If you want to just do nothing, then that's fine too. If you're walking around early in the morning, no one bothers you. If you're walking around late at night, no one bothers you. It is a very unique experience. So I'm getting used to that experience. And it doesn't bother me. I don't feel like, oh, wait a minute, where's the control systems? On the golf course, I was the last one on the course. No one was behind me. So I just could take my time. I just took a lot of video. Beautiful place, a lot of video. You'll see some of it. And nobody pressuring me. So I got to a whole tee box. I said, over there, here, waterfall. I'm just going to go over there. So I just went over there and took video of the waterfall and just hung out there. Then walked back to the tee box. Actually, I kind of ran a little bit. I said, maybe I'm getting someone behind me. No, look, no, nobody's there. No marshal. A marshal just drove past. There's nobody behind me. They don't have to say anything. I asked him, do I need to be in by a certain time? He said, no. Anytime you come in, it's fine. We'll be here. No problem. So I came in. It was dark. The bighorn sheep are there. I just stopped. I hit my tee shot on 16. I stopped. The bighorn sheep are right there. I'm 10 feet away from, and I just stop. And I just taking video and just hanging out. There's some bighorn sheep climbing the mountain behind me. I take video of that. It was super intense. And I said, you know what? I'm good. That's enough. I'm good. And I just drove into the clubhouse. I just left my ball out on the fairway. I didn't even go try to find it. I said, forget it. That's a donation. A donation for tomorrow's golfers. They'll come by and they'll see a ball presumably in the fairway. Maybe it's not. Yeah, I don't know. I don't care. Doesn't matter. Forgot my scorecard. Didn't matter. Left it on the car. Who cares? I had a hard time driving home. The intensity, the wow was so strong, I had a hard time driving, actually. I almost had two accidents. So that's a lesson to be learned. I was in a hurry to get back. Shouldn't have been. I should have just sat in the car for like a half an hour and just abided in the wow and calmed down. Because I was really, it was very intense. Now, there's a subplot to all of this, what we're doing here, this whole situation. There's a subplot. There's several things. There's the realization of the self, which is, again, I promise everyone, it's very, 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 quote-unquote, doable. We absolutely can realize the self here. Okay, that's one. The other is seems to be this preparation for a higher realm, okay, a better place. We don't have all this control system that's coming into the world at all, where you're really free to just go wherever you want to go and do whatever you want to do, and nobody is bossing you around or telling policing you or anything. There's no crime. There's no fear. There's nothing like that. Everyone is responsible, and knows how to, knows how to conduct themselves, appropriately. And amazing service and hospitality. No matter what you chose, I'll try this to eat this. Oh, that's great. That's really good. You want this? No problem. You want this? No problem. Not even no problem. They're, happy to say, yeah, sure, right out. Yeah, it's just, smart. You can't make a wrong decision, basically. You cannot make a wrong decision. This is the experience. You can't make a wrong decision. Everywhere you drive, everywhere you look, it's beautiful. Well, if I turn here, is that going to be a dead end, terrible? No, it's beautiful. Turn here. Oh, it's beautiful. There's no wrong decisions. quite intense experience. So there's that. So realization of the oneself, the isness, is very much possible here, and not at all some distant goal, really. When we practice this wow practice, it's not distant at all. It's quite close. So there's that. Then there's the possibility that there's going to be a shift into a higher realm. All right, for those who are prepared. Then there's this third subplot. Now I went on this getaway from the Silicon Valley to get away from concerns. I want to experience no concern. Well, it didn't quite happen that way. In fact, there was this theme that kept happening over and over and over and over and over and over. It wouldn't stop. And eventually it got my attention and I became rather alarmed. It just wouldn't stop. I said, come on, one, two, three, four, all these strong attention getters keep popping up, and that they're all around the same theme. They're all around the same theme. So I just kept brushing aside. So I don't want to think about that. I don't want to think about that. I don't want to think. Finally, the man I got paired with just happened out of the blue. Even the circumstances of that were quite extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. I won't get into that, but it was obviously a huge attention getter what happened. And around the 16th hole, interesting, he suddenly starts talking. He starts introducing, and maybe on the 15th he introduced it, and then on the 16th we really talked about it. He started talking about catastrophe, global catastrophe, and how he was really, really interested in that and aware of that, and started talking about asteroids hitting the Earth. Now, this came out of the blue. This is not someone you think would say anything like that. He didn't seem to be that type of person at all. And ultimately, it came out that he was very concerned, very stressed out, and worried and concerned, and was very knowledgeable about extinction level events, asteroids hitting the planet, and what would happen, all this stuff. And I said, wow, I'm exactly the same. We were very similar, it turns out, people with a lot of similarities. And I said, I know all about all this stuff. I have a lifetime of study about, extinction level events and things like that. But this just came out of the blue. I mean, popped out of nowhere. He just said, "Do you know the name of this guy, so-and-so?" And I said, sounds sort of familiar. And they said, "Well, he kind of talks about, he's sort of talking about, catastrophes and stuff." And then we went, and that just, went shifted from golf into awareness of asteroids. And he said, "Did you know that in October, this very large asteroid went past the Earth, quite close, actually?" And I said, "Yeah, I did hear something about that." And we didn't even know about it, And he said, that we could be hit any time. And I said, well, that's true. I know that. Well, this was exactly all of the attention getters that I was getting was about. Then I realized, oh my gosh, about getting hit by an asteroid, the ocean. And it kept going on and on and on. It didn't stop there. And I kind of was upset. I said, I came down here to peaceful, have a peaceful, enjoying, enjoying vacation, and hopefully a staycation. But I don't want to be bothered by this stuff. I mean, come on, what could you do about that? But it wouldn't stop. It wouldn't stop. It's ongoing. And I have to say, every time I ask the Holy Spirit, what's going to happen, really, this whole asteroid theme comes up. Get the ocean, an asteroid going into the ocean. And then last night I looked at a website. Somehow I came across this, which gave a detail. They now have a scientists have a detailed description of what would happen if an asteroid, a large asteroid, hit the ocean. And I have to say it was pretty accurate. And it's very similar to the dream that I had of what's going to happen in this world. So there is a science to it, to starting to understand what happens. So there's this underlying theme also that I can't seem to get away from it. It was the last thing on my mind. absolutely did not want to focus on that at all, and I still don't want to focus. What can you say? You know, it's just a doomsday sort of thing. You don't want to dwell on anything like that, but something, the circumstances keep arising relentlessly to try to make me aware of this. And it's hard, you know, you cannot ignore it. So that's the third subplot. I mean, there's so many incidents happen that eventually I just sort of had to start laughing. You know, it's just, somebody wants my attention. I'm taking video and I'm standing by this bridge over water, and suddenly I hear this whoo, this whiz like that whoo, tong, and then I said, what happened? And I heard a plop. I said, oh my gosh, someone hit a golf ball from far away. It narrowly missed me, hitting me, hit the metal bridge, the metal sides of this bridge, and ricocheted and then landed in the water. I said, there you go again. I mean, an asteroid coming in and you know, hitting the, you know, going into the water, you know, hitting the atmosphere and then going into the water. It just wouldn't end. It just wouldn't end. I'm taking video of this waterway, and suddenly something comes in, poof, plops right in the water. It was a golf ball. It was my partner. He hit a golf ball right in. It was a very crazy shot, you know. It was way off the course. He said, wow, I don't know how he did that. That's in the video. So then later on, a couple hours later, I'm taking video of this waterway in a different place. The same darn thing happens. Boom! This golf ball, splash in the water. He hit another one in there. Again, a very, very errant, wild shot. And he says, I don't... And we were laughing at it. And he says, wow. How is that possible that we did it twice? You know, and we just couldn't believe what was happening. I mean, the both of us were just having these experiences out there, again, symbolizing something coming in and, you know, striking the water. So I'd say this is sort of an overall assessment of where we're at in the world. We have the spiritual path that works, okay? It absolutely works. I'm convinced of this. We have this preparation to go into a higher realm. And we also have this awareness of the potentiality of an asteroid hitting the ocean and what would happen in this world. So these are the three plots that we have. I remember I had the most profound experience of the self, where I realized that this orphan that I'd been raising really was the self. Truth is an orphan here in this world. And this, I realized that I said, okay, I'm going to put you on probation. You can leave. You don't need to turn in. I turned in some thesis, I was supposed to say a thesis to show me that you've learned something here. And with the thesis that it turned in was just this picture of aimlessness. And I got upset. I said, what do you mean? I've tried to teach you everything I know, and this is, you haven't learned anything? And I suddenly had this epiphany of realizing this is the true self here. It doesn't need to learn anything. There's nothing to learn, and it knows this. So what it showed me was an accurate picture of this world, which is total aimlessness. And so then I said, oh, wow. And this is when I experienced the self in the most profound way, of this shining, radiating, not of electromagnetic light, but of a feeling of bliss and joy and gratitude and love and freedom and peace. It's just complete, without any gap in it. The radiation was just this presence, this radiating presence of this. And then it seemed to disappear. I saw it going somewhere really quickly. And I saw it was going into this parkland, like a beautiful golf course. I said, oh, I thought it would come back, but it doesn't like this world. It doesn't value this world at all. The world we're living in, there's no value. This world is an attempt to learn to do the impossible, to try and scam God. There's no value in that. It's a belief, mental projection, and a belief that this is leading somewhere. But from the standpoint of truth, this is just completely aimless. It's just aimless wandering around. So if you're going to wander around aimlessly, why not wander around in some beautiful setting, right? Where you, that reminds you of reality, the nature of reality. So this self seemed to leave me. I felt I'd been abandoned. But I'm starting to see maybe, well, let's just say be stronger than maybe. I'm starting to have this notion, trending in this direction, let's say, that it's setting up this beautiful parkland. It's getting ready to abide in that. It's pre-familiarizing itself with that so that the shift can happen. This so-called I that we have, this guide, is a scam artist, okay? The guide to time, the guide to helpfulness. We don't need any helpfulness, except to recognize we don't need any helpfulness. So we don't need this I. This is not what we are. The presumed personality, the identity we have, is not. It's just a hustler. It's been hustling us. That's all it is. It's just a hustler. We've just been hustled here. We don't need that hustler. So when we begin to drop we realize I don't need this hustler. I don't need an I, a guide to helpfulness, a guide to learning. I don't need a guide to learning. Then we begin to experience freedom from that. And that's the staycation, workcation, the workcation that I had, just got back from it yesterday, Tuesday. I worked Wednesday, today's Thanksgiving, so I'm trying to rest. It was, a lot of driving, very intense, very rigorous and intense, but this was the experience of I don't need to learn anything. Nobody's telling me what my learning goals need to be. Nobody's trying to force helpfulness upon me at all. This is an extraordinary experience. It was the best hospitality I've ever experienced. I say it was flawless because nobody tried to be solicitous and be helpful. No one tried to be helpful. They were just there. If you needed help, they were helpful. But no one like smiles, hey, I'm here to be helpful. I want to be helpful to you. Is the ultimate in the right training in, for hospitality, really. And it's almost invisible. But if they see, like you wander over to the concierge desk, and they see that, and then they come over and smile, and but they don't try to push the helpfulness upon you. And if you decide no, they don't like look like, oh, I'm so upset I wasn't able to help you. None of that either. I see. I almost couldn't sleep at night, the last night there, because I was trying to find ways to praise the situation sufficiently. And I worked on hours. I was working on it. Just how do you praise it? Non-solicitous helpfulness. And the helpfulness was right, direct, to the point and quick. What time does the pool open? What time? Just to give you the facts. Thank you. And that's it. I'm glad I could help. We're here anytime you need us. They just reassure us. We're here. Whatever questions you have, we're here for you. That's it. They didn't tell you. They didn't start volunteering a bunch of information, blah, 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 blah. No. They just say, whatever you need, we're here for you. And that's it. And they are. So this is like a precursor experience to the way higher realms are, called the death-free realm. And the amazing thing was that the man that I was paired with, I didn't want to bother him, but I finally said, "Yeah, I want to take a video here." And later on, he started taking video. And I said, "You take video too?" He says, "Yeah, I like taking video too." So we just would stop, and we just take video of this beautiful scenery, and then say, "Okay, now we can go." It's like amazing. Even his job was similar, and we could relate. "Oh, I drive all the time." "Yeah." He said, "Yeah, I had to get out of the LA area. It's horrible." I said, "I had to get out of the Silicon Valley area. It's horrible." So the Holy Spirit set that whole meeting up right there. I didn't force, I didn't get his name, number or anything, to contact or anything like that. But in spirit, the contact is there in spirit, so to speak. Very helpful. I'm sure it was very helpful for him in a subtle way. Hindsight, usually we see it in hindsight. And the quicker your hindsight is, the quicker the path can go. And so, I'm having fairly quick hindsight these days in summing up. What was that for? We only realize in hindsight, say, "Oh, wow, that was really helpful. I didn't really quite realize it at the time. I'm not quite sure what is this, but..." I saw this jaguar. It was in this outdoor enclosure, but it was just sitting there. It was sleeping, kind of. And then it raised its head and looked at me, saw me, and said, "There's that." And was just looking at me. Now, jaguars, they can put the look on you. There's no look quite like that. It's a different look, isn't it, than all other animals, really. The lion is similar, the big cats. And it was just looking at me intently like this. And I was just looking back intently at it. And then I started to say, "Hey, jaguar, go vertical. You can go vertical. I give you permission to go vertical. All of now is right now. You can go vertical. You're not stuck here. You're not fixated here." And so instead of like this fear thing, it was like a communion thing. It was like I was there's a spiritual transmission as saying, "Hey, you're just as free to go vertical as I am." And then I felt the look was a different look. It was a softer look. And then the big cat, kind of said, "Ah, thank you, thank you." And then it kind of put its head down again after quite some time. And but this glaring, the big cat glare, the way they look, because I didn't react to it in that way, it softened up. There was something there. It was quite extraordinary. Many extraordinary experiences I had that took place because I allowed myself the intensity of it. But I'm telling you what intensity that was. Rode on a camel, rode on a camel. Wow. That really shifted my perspective in a lot of ways. Always wanted to ride on a camel. Suddenly the opportunity arose. I jumped on it, figuratively and literally, and it was awesome. People I know, a lot of people make jokes about camel traders and camel riders and all this stuff. But I'll tell you what, when you're in the desert, you would love to have a camel. That's the only way to travel, really. I mean, the camel just moves through the desert and you're up above it all. And it's smooth, And the camel just has this way of moving that, it's just, and it's just up there. Wow, it's beautiful. I can see why people value camels, really, in the desert dwelling peoples. It's nothing to sneer at or laugh at. And then I thought camels were dangerous and nasty. Well, some can be, but not all. This one, after I got off the ride, it turned its head towards me and put its head right up so I could pat it on the head and look right into its eye. And it was just looking at me with the most beautiful expression and kindly knowing expression, you know, is like amazing. I said, wow, camels are wonderful creatures, really. I said, I'd like to have a camel, actually. It's awesome. There's something about the leisureliness in, you know, of a camel, the steadiness. And the height, of course, is quite high. It's higher than a horse, in my opinion, you know. It felt, you're up there. And it's, yeah, so very, very interesting experience. Got to feed a giraffe by my hand, look eye to eye, head to head with a huge giraffe. And the giraffe just saying, thank you very much for the food, and how are you? And it's like, whoa, I'm eyeball to eyeball with a giraffe, you know. who does know that? And, you know, most of the stuff only kids were doing. But I said, hey, I'm a kid too, actually. I mean, why do we think that adults have it right? Why? Because they've done more learning, right? Well, kids are still in the awareness that I don't really need to learn anything at all. I'm spirit. I just experiencing is fed. It's experiencing. But the adults say, okay, well, you got to learn. Eventually, you got to learn all this. Learn about this separate will that... this presumptive separate will that is should come into focus any time now. We got to learn to get ready for that. So there's all these little kids taking the camel rides, you know. I said, hey, I asked, can I take a ride? They said, of course. The little kids weren't scared at all. This little tiny tot, you know, was asked the mother, I said, hey, you know, he's not scared? And he says, oh, no, this is her second time. He loves it. And the adults are, I said, you want to go? Oh, no. The adults are saying, oh, no. They're scared. The adults are scared. They don't, you know. Not the little kids. The little kids, wow, it's amazing. Little kids are feeding the giraffe, too, and loving it, enjoying it, and... So where we have these three very important areas we're talking about, right? Where we're looking, not talking about, we're experiencing the wow of these three areas. I would say this is an accurate description. It's in the ballpark, what's going on here. Experiencing the wow. Three different areas. Wow, humanity, this whole situation here is not something that is necessarily without troubles going forward. Remember, the imperilment is how we, in trying to imperil ourselves, is how we're trying to generate extra will to create new will, to be a creator of ourselves. So imperilment is the central feature of our this dream that we're dreaming, trying to create a separate will. Now, in order to be imperiled, we have to identify with something that can be ruined, destroyed and think that it is what that is what we are. So we can believe in impairment. So these bodies are something we have made as a device, an impairment device, to identify with them and believe that we can be destroyed, be imperiled, right? This that then we think will generate more spiritual will in us. So the whole purpose of this dream is impairment, actually. I mean, pragmatic purpose is impairment. We feel this is the effective practice we need. Now, in the death-free realm, there's no impairment. You can see nothing's ever been imperiled here. Nothing's ever been harmed in any way. And yet there's still beautiful nature. Beautiful. It's very beautiful. The golf course I was on was extraordinarily beautiful. One of the most beautiful in the world. There is no question about that. I don't have to go to every golf course in the world. I mean, I've been out, I've walked along Pebble Beach. I mean, they say, yeah, that's beautiful. This one, you know, I'd say is more beautiful. Or you can say it's equally. I mean, there's, whether you like ocean or desert or mountains or whatever, you know, there's different, people have different likes as far as stuff. But this had just gorgeous in every way. So the death-free realm is very beautiful, but there's nothing there that's in peril at all. Everything that's there has never suffered from any harm at all. And this helps us get let go of this dream of imperilment without having to do it all at once. Having to, you know, just, okay, you know, disappearance of the universe right now, you know, something like that, or disappearance of all form or whatever, you know. Nature vanish. No, that's stupid. That's folly. That's trying to show off. Why try to do it that way? That is arrogant in some ways, because we're not honoring our creativity. We've been extraordinarily creative in our attempt to scam ourselves, scam God, create different wills. So we, you know, acknowledge our creativity. That's not acknowledging God, really. To do it right away, saying, "Oh no, you know, I wasn't creative at all in this attempt to scam God," is, you know, so there's no continuity issue whatsoever. You know. This is again trying to, is arrogance. Really. Now, if it just naturally arises that this what's happened, then that's what has happened, but to try and force it, that leap, so to speak, that's arrogance. The big leap, the complete total leap, you know, to try and force that, no, that's being arrogant. Let us honor our creativity. Just being on that golf course, and it, you know, I just said, wow, this is really, I had to admire and praise just the overall conception of this and how beautiful it was. It's just, I mean, let's go back, you know, really. I'm ready to go back right today. I didn't get enough of it. No, but I want to hang out more. I was too busy, you know. Next time, I just want to settle in and maybe not do as much. Just hang out there. And everybody, you know, is casually. You know, it's nice to be in a place where everyone's tourists, because they're in this mood too of escaping their routine. Everybody's friendly. Everybody's kind of relaxed, except. Except, here's another experience I had. Went out, I was the last person went out, basically, by myself on this day. And there actually, there's one group behind me, an elderly couple, and they were going along, tottering along very slowly. So I had plenty of time to take video and relax. It was great. And suddenly this guy in a cart, this man with his wife and little baby, comes driving up. And then drives past me and down to the next hole. And I said, what's he doing? I guess he's trying to find some opening where there's open hole or something. I said, well, there's a lot of golfers ahead of us. I don't think there's anywhere for you to go. Then later on, I'm at this green, near this green, and ready to hit a shot, real close to the green. And suddenly I hear this thump comes whizzing past me. Thump. I said, where the heck did that come from? Again, another asteroid thing of this something coming from the sky, whoosh, unexpectedly, wham, impacting. I said, he almost hit me. What happened? And I look, and there's this guy way back on the tee. He teed off and almost hit me with his golf ball. I said, "Wow." Well, I was in a blind spot, but where'd he come from? Well, it was this guy again. I won't give his nationality or whatever. I mean, it's not really important. So I said, "Wow." And I feel this pressure. Suddenly, I feel being really pressured severely. And the next hole, then I have to wait for those people ahead of me. It's slow. It's slow. It's slow. So I'm waiting, and he comes up right behind me. Wait, he's finished the hole, and I can feel this guy's in like some major pressure mode, that he's been driving around the golf course trying to find a way to get past everybody, and now he's right on my tail. I can feel this hostile pressure. Get out of my way. Get out of my way. So it's like ruining the experience for me totally. So finally, I hit my tee shot on this hole, and there's obviously people ahead of me and people ahead. There's nowhere to go, and he's up there on the tee, like gone. I said, "Well, what am I? I can't go anywhere. What are you doing?" He was out of his mind. He didn't get out of my way. What is this? So I said, "If I get out of your way, there's another group ahead of them, another group ahead of them, another group ahead of them. Come on." But no. So he was just like completely in this mode of that we get in the Silicon Valley and we get in LA area. And I talked to someone from Canada. Also, they have the same problem in Vancouver, British Columbia, same thing. It's all over the world now. It's really extraordinary. Everyone is in this frantic mode, get out of my way. So finally, he screams at me, "Four," like as if I'm supposed to like vanish, get out of the way. Maybe we can vanish from here, and maybe that'd be a good idea to vanish from here to into a higher realm. Well, so he is really on my tail and just ungodly pressure. So I get to the next hole. I'm asking the Holy Spirit, "What do I do? This is ruining my whole the whole experience I came here for. It's ruining it." And there's something came to mind. Jesus said to practice. It says, "I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am the one that is at home here. It's fear that's the stranger here." Okay, Jesus said this is a very important practice. Well, I said, "I'm so desperate. I'm going to try this." So I started saying this. "I am the one that is, I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. Fear is a stranger here." And I just kept saying that, and I started feeling better. I had before I had gotten this very fearful, angry mode of thinking, thinking, thinking. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? But now I was just, "I am at home. Fear is the stranger here." And I was relaxed. I relaxed. The fear started to dissipate. "I am at home. Fear is the stranger here." And then suddenly, this guy in this golf cart comes whizzing up beside me, and he stops and he goes, "Do you mind if I pass you by? Can I pass you by? Can I pass you by?" And I said, "Be my guest. Be my guest." And I waved him up, and he goes, "Ooh, yawn." And just like that, he was out of my life, completely gone. Never had an, Later on, I saw him. He had somehow he was still trying to get his way, fight his way through all the groups. He was way up ahead somewhere, but I just saw kind of distance, But he was gone. He was gone. All the pressure vanished for me. And then it was just this elderly couple who never pressured me at all. They quit after 9 holes, and I had no one behind me at all. All the pressure vanished. It is a miracle. I don't know why he was passing me. There was nowhere to go. But he suddenly that's what happened. So I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. So fear is looking for a home, But I said, "Where I am at home. I am is home. I am home. Fear, I am home. Fear is the stranger here." Okay, I'm not the stranger here. Fear is the stranger here. It was a miracle. So I said, "Thank you, Holy Spirit. It's quite extraordinary." And then the rest of the day was a miraculous day of positive intensity, extreme positive intensity. I experienced extreme positive intensity on this trip. Even the food was extremely positively intense to food. It was just, the best. And the final night, I did find the greatest waiter in the world. This is a surprise. He did wait upon us. I set it all up. It was fabulous. It was incredible. He's a genius. He's a virtuoso. He's better than ever. And the meal, being a vegetarian, he suggested this meal. He said, "You're gonna love this. It's fabulous." Well, it was. It was incredible. It was a mushroom and noodle, fettuccine noodle sort of thing, and it was better than having meat in it. It was beyond delicious. It was just, I can't hard describe it. I've never had mushrooms like that taste like anything like that. I can't even tell you what the taste. It was just incredible. He was right. And then dessert. Let's get to dessert. I can tell you it was the best dessert I've ever had in my life. Period. And what was that dessert? One scoop of chocolate ice cream and one scoop of vanilla ice cream with a little bit of cream on top and a couple of little sticks of some crunchy, pastry or something. That's it. That's all what it was. One scoop of chocolate ice cream, one scoop of vanilla ice cream, sitting side by side. Best dessert ever had. Best ice cream I've ever had. I asked the waiter, "You said you," I said, "pick, because there's five types of chocolate and five types of vanilla. Single sourced, meaning the flavor, the chocolate bean is from this source only, the vanilla bean is from this source only. Costa Rica, Indonesia, Sumatra, Madagascar, various places around the world." And it was the best vanilla ice cream I've ever had. Nothing even came close. It was also the best chocolate. The chocolate was a little icy on the outside, but that happens. That's fine. The chocolate was extraordinarily good, but the vanilla was the best. And the combination of the two, and there was no aftertaste, no lingering dessert aftertaste at all. It was just clean. I don't know how that's possible. And he just said, "That's it. You're never going to top that dessert. I mean, that's the best dessert I've ever had in my life. I mean, that's quite extraordinary. I mean, all of us have probably had a lot of different desserts in our life." Right? Thinking about it, right? This was the best. Totally simple. Totally simple. Black and white, chocolate and vanilla. The simplest of desserts. It was the best. Gave a huge tip. Basically, all the money I had left in the world to the waiter. He was awesome. Better than ever. And someone who has very high, strict standards for waiters and hospitality, etc. They were there, and I said, "Well, how about," he said, "he's really, really good. Yeah, he's really, really good." If they say he's good, he's got to be fabulous. And of course, I was watching how he was with everybody else. Fabulous with everybody. Complete virtuoso. And again, the food was just amazing. Had no heartburn, no afterfeel, no after effects. It's like perfect. The food is so good. It's not too rich. It's not too much. It somehow it's compatible with eating. Whereas other stuff, I mean, I did order this mushroom fettuccine the night before, this other place, and they did tell me it's very rich. Well, they were right. It was very rich. It was too filling, too rich, caused, after effects sort of thing. Whereas this was not like that. It was not rich. It was not dripping in sauce or anything. It was just all the food. How was it? Everyone said it's perfect. It was perfect. Awesomely good food. Not too much, nothing ostentatious. It was just right. Rarely do we experience anything like this, where everything just seems just right. Not too much, not too little, not too much, not this, not that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that. So this was the Holy Spirit set up the whole thing. And what's next? I'm ready for the next thing. I was able to handle the whole trip. Very strenuous thing. Driving over 1,000 miles. In intense, you know, of course, California intense traffic. I have to compliment everybody in California, especially the drivers in Los Angeles. They drive very well. I always said the Los Angeles drivers are the best drivers in the world. Southern California drivers are the best drivers in the world. It's only when I got up towards more to Northern California where the knuckleheads showed up. There was one knucklehead going on the way down, but I'm sure they were coming from the north, you know, and they almost wrecked us. I mean, it was just a crazy, crazy, crazy driver, to say the least, you know, just insane. But down in Southern California, people let you in. You know, if you're in trouble, they let you in. They give you space to get in. They also realize they got to jam in too, but they understand you're in the same boat too. So they look, you know, I've never had a problem with Los Angeles traffic. Everybody say, oh, LA drivers are terrible. No, they're not. I think they're really, really good drivers, because they've been driving on these crowded freeways their whole lives, you know? Whereas other people, when the crowding just happens, like Silicon Valley, it's getting so terrible, it's happened the last 3 years, they're not used to it, so it's driving them crazy. They can't handle it. Down there, this is just normal for everybody. Everybody understands. So everybody was just fabulous on the whole trip. You know, everybody treated us fabulously. And I mentioned to the someone in charge of the place we're staying, we're leaving. I said, you know, everything, it was just absolutely magnificent. You just shine. I mean, you're just tremendous. He said, you know what? It's people like you that allow us to shine. He says it works both ways. It's the guests, good guests. He says, well, the reason why we're so good here is because we have such good guests. And I said, I understand. Yeah, okay, I get it, which is true. The guests are extraordinarily good. They're calm. They're very conservative, meaning in a calm way. They're not out to cause trouble. They're not hellraisers. You know, they're there for peace and quiet. And the response, they're responsible. They're intelligent, responsible. They're calm. You know, and so he said, you know, it works both ways. It's the guests that come here which make this place what it is. And I agreed with him. I said, I get it. You know, the people were very, very good, you know, really. I mean, not, you wouldn't say perfect in terms of there were people that, but everyone behaved themselves appropriately, you know. Nobody's screaming, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me, you know, anything like that. No. You know, most of the people there are very successful people. I talked to someone there, a lot of them from Canada. And Canadians are very friendly people, but very, very well-behaved people, Canadians, you know, and most of them are quite wealthy, actually. And, you know, they've already got it made. They're not saying, look at me, look at me, look at me. Yeah, I don't know. It's just the attitude is so. Very interesting. I'm sure the death-free realm will praise the death-free realm, and the death-free realm will say, hey, it's because of you, you know, that I'm able to shine, that I'm this way. It's the ones that come here that you know, enable the whole situation to be as it is. Same thing with the golf course. It's the golfers that help make the situation very responsible. I mean, let's face it, most of the people down there are quite wealthy. And I'm able to just fake that I fit in because actually I'm a spiritual trillionaire. So knowing that, I don't feel intimidated by people say, well, you know, there's the people I'm, you know, I own 20 properties and I'm, you know, I've got this, you know, they're millionaires, you know, and well, you know, well, that's, you know, material wealth. I have spiritual wealth. I'm a spiritual trillionaire. So I don't, you know, feel inferior to these people. And basically, it's assumed if you're there, you are wealthy, you are responsible, you are a very responsible person. So everybody, nobody, you know, that's assumed, completely assumed. So nobody looks at you otherwise at all. So if you're in the death-free realm, it's assumed that you're very wise, and you are. Absolutely. Assume you're a spiritual trillionaire. You are a spiritual trillionaire. You know, you can afford this place spiritually. You can afford the death-free realm. Absolutely. So the higher realms, the company of sages. I'm driving back home. I had this realization that in weighing, I value the company of spiritual sages more than I value this world. This is what I realized. It suddenly came to me, you know, what do you value more, the world or the company of sages? And I said, I do value the company of the sages more than the world. Had this realization. That was a very big wow there. Quite stunning. What's more important? What do I want more? What do I really want? The world or the company of sages? The company of sages. Absolutely. That's absolutely what I want. So the scales tipped. You know, the scales tipped. It wasn't like, I don't know. I clearly decided the company of sages is what I truly want. Doesn't mean we would be devoid of a world or a realm. No. Death-free realm, higher realms are there for us because we want to honor our creativity. That's why they're there. And at the same time, set down this, you know, silly pretense that we can learn, you know, we can develop a separate will. And all the accoutrement of, you know, believing that there's a path to doing that. You know, we don't need that. We don't need to believe there's a path to doing the impossible. We don't need to believe there's a process. We don't need to believe there's a timing of it. You know, process implies time, doesn't it? We don't need to believe in any of that. Okay. Very cold here. Came back, came to Silicon Valley. It's a storm, it's cold as snow in the mountains. It is chilly. So coming back to Silicon Valley was a real bummer. I can tell you this. All the negativity came back. Started to get close to it. All this defensiveness and negativity and darkness, everything came back. You know, this is the world. You know, the worldliness of the place is very bad. And I tried not to get depressed about it or struggle with it. As I just said, okay, I don't know what to do about this. I can't stop it. It's coming back. You know, I felt like it was leaving me. And all this tension, I had terrible tension and soreness in my neck here. And I realized it's gone now. You know, just getting away from this area, it's gone. But, so, definitely I do not like this place. Never have really liked this place at all. Really don't like it now. And just pray to the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit remove all helpfulness from my life, because this Silicon Valley is the heart of the belief in helpfulness. They believe that they're helping the whole world learn how to do the impossible, learn how to create a separate will. So the Silicon Valley people think they're being extraordinarily helpful. In fact, they're saying, get out of my way, I'm a helpful person. I'm so helpful, you need to get out of my way, you're hindering my helpfulness. And so, a terrible place. I have to say, it is a terrible, terrible place, Silicon Valley, Bay Area. The San Francisco Bay Area is a terrible place. Very anti-spiritual place. But thinking that it's the most spiritual place in the world, it is an egoic spirituality. See, the ego thinks it is spirituality. The ego thinks it's extraordinarily spiritual. it really does. So the ego thinks that Bay Area is just like a wonderfully spiritual place, when in fact, it's a extraordinarily anti-spiritual place. Because it believes in helpfulness. Of course, if you believe in helpfulness, you believe that there's something that needs to be helped. There's some vulnerability, some lack, some neediness. That's deposit a separate will. Because in God's will, there's no neediness at all. There's only perfection. So to say I want to be helpful means I want to separate from God. It's anti-God. This is very much an anti-God place in Silicon Valley. It's extraordinarily anti-God here. You can feel the intensity of the anti-Godness here. Really horrible. All the while feeling that they're being supremely helpful to the world. Helpful to everyone. Helpful, helpful, helpful. Don't be helpful to me, please. Don't be helpful. So it's amazing to flip the script and ask, you know, we all ask God, help God, help God. What we should be saying, God, please don't help. Don't help. I know you're not being helping me. Thank you for not helping me, God. And I want to experience your total non-helpfulness, please. And I know the way to do that, first I have this intermediate step where I will be helped to recognize I don't need to be helped. That's okay, God. I'll accept that. But I know that you're not helping me at all because I don't need to be helped. I'm perfect. You created me perfect, flawlessly perfect, forever and ever. To say that I need help is an extraordinarily arrogant statement, anti-God statement. So I asked the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, remove all helpfulness from me except for the death-free realm. Remove all helpfulness from me except for the death-free realm, Holy Spirit. This is the real prayer. Say, God, remove all helpfulness from me. Free me from all helpfulness except for the death-free realm. Okay? With that one exception. Let this be our prayer now. So I did this morning. I mean, this, talk about flipping a script. You cannot flip a script more than this. This may be the ultimate script flipping that I experienced this morning. And the wow was, you know, was there very strong, but not too strong. I mean, I'm fine. But certainly, yes, I realized, wow, that's a huge one. God, don't help me. Free me from all notion of helpfulness. Remove me from helpfulness, Holy Spirit, except from for the death-free realm. Remove all blocks, all these helpfulness blocks from me, except for the death-free realm. This is the prayer that gets us to the death-free realm. I feel very strongly. Reason tells me that this is it. I haven't experienced it yet. Well, I did experience the presence this morning, yeah. So I would say reason is telling me this is the way to practice now. God, don't help me to get well. Don't help me in any way. God, don't help me in any way except the death-free realm. Thank you very much. This should be our prayer. God, please don't help me in any way and free me from any notion of helpfulness except for the death-free realm. That's it. So, I would venture to say there is are very few, unfortunately, in the world speaking like this, teaching like this, sharing like this, encouraging like this, saying, I'm only here to help us realize we don't need any help at all, to free us from helpfulness. We're not used to this. We're not used to hearing this. I know I'm not at all. I've never heard anyone speak like this, actually. I really have not. And yet, intuitively, I know this is the highest teaching. This is the best teaching, actually. Free God, free me from all helpfulness except for the death-free realm. I don't want any helpfulness whatsoever. This world is this conglomeration of helpfulness. What is help? What do we need helpfulness? We don't need to be helped. Does reality need help? Who could help reality? This is the delusion. So, I expect the Holy Spirit to be removing the blocks to the awareness of the death-free realm now. And this is where our presence is easily experienced, that is for sure. And we can even experience our presence, the presence of isness, this effortless, non-helping presence, right now. I just experienced it this morning. And it was not being solicitous, like, what can I do to help you? It was just there, that's all. It was just there, it was just present. It wasn't trying to do anything for me or help me out in any way. But, of course, This helps me realize what I am doesn't need any help. And that's the only realization we need. And it's only a temporary realization, because once we realize we don't need any help, that we don't need even the realization we don't need any help, it's done. And once we get familiar with that, we're done with all the notion of helpfulness entirely. So this is a big one, because this issue of helpfulness is something that this is what has held us back. I see this now. Yeah, it's dawning upon me, and I'm just taking it in stride. You know, it's ready. We're ready for this. It's the big one, because who in the world can argue against helpfulness? You seem like to be an absolute selfish moron if you do, right? So this is the backlash I got in this world, trying to just stay with the presence of I am. The people say, you're so selfish. You're not letting us help you, not letting anyone anyway help you. You don't want any help. What a terrible, rotten person you are, you know. Well, I say, I'm not a person. I'm spirit. Spirit doesn't need any help. Yeah, but you need to help others. No, I don't. There's no persons here. There's no things here at all. There's nothing that needs help here, actually. Everything is just a mental projection. See, when we see it that way, we realize there really isn't any need for help here at all. Not in the tiniest bit, except to realize there isn't any need for help here at all. I'm looking at that jaguar, and I'm saying, you don't need my help. You can go vertical yourself. You are vertical. You are spirit. You don't need my help. I'm just reassuring you. No, you can do it. You can do it too. I'm going to do it. You can do it too. I'm sure you're not so happy about make-believing that you're a jaguar, you know? Right? Consciousness. Well, awareness. Consciousness is really awareness conceptualized. An attempt to change awareness, actually. How are we doing here? It's quite chilly out here. My gosh. Not happy about that. I don't like coldness. Chilly this coldness. So I'm walking early in the morning, 5:30 in the morning, around, going behind buildings, going places, you know, like, and the maintenance crew, instead of like looking at me like, who's that? What are they doing? Instead, they say they either just ignore you completely, or in passing, at least they smile and I just to say good morning, you know, good morning. There's nobody saying who's that. Isn't that awesome? And I'm not going to cause any trouble. Someone invited me to be a bit of a troublemaker, actually, and I ultimately turned it down. I didn't show up for the appointment. They said, "Well, we can go to this place and this place." And I said, "Yeah, but they don't really they don't want you out there." I said, "Yeah, but we're not bothering anybody." And then I actually went there myself a little bit, out on the golf course, and then there were some people playing there. I said, I don't want to bother them. And later on, they kind of gave me this look like, what were you doing out there? And I realized, no, you know, don't abuse the hospitality. Don't take advantage of it to do stuff that is not appropriate, you know? Don't need to do that. If I want to go on the golf course, I'll go out on the golf course the right way. So if you give a history of people behaving appropriately at a place, then nobody's looking over their shoulder at you, you see? Whereas if you go, and then another experience is coming home, you're in a parking space and some person came out of the store and says, "Hey, we think you might be trying to go over there to the restaurant and use this parking space. We don't want you to do that," and blah, blah, blah. It really gave me a hard time. I said, "No, we're just looking for a bathroom." "Oh, well, we have one." "Well, we didn't know that." So you get getting hassled. for just parking in a parking space for a couple of minutes. And there's all these signs that right in front of us saying, no loitering, no trespass, no loitering, no, it's forbidden. You know, police will be called. And another says, no drugs, no drug paraphernalia, no loitering, no this. All these signs, you know, police number of the police department on, you know, basically saying, we don't want anybody hanging around. Why? Because all these people are behaving badly. As soon as you get out in, you know, into these other areas, there's just all this crime, this gang activity, drug activity. Everybody's looking for an opportunity to behave badly, so everybody's looking over their shoulder at everybody else. And it's just sort of a collective paranoia. Down there, nobody is looking over their shoulders. Even that golf ball, you know, the golf ball went whizzing by, almost hit me and hit the bridge and fell in the canal. I didn't say a word. I said, well, it didn't hit me. Holy Spirit's got my back. This was just showing me about this asteroid issue. So that I say to them, hey, you know, what are you doing? You almost hit me. No. I didn't have any vibe at all. Never said a word to anybody. Didn't even have an angry vibe, nothing. I just casual, I'm happy, you know. Hey, I just trust in the Holy Spirit. That was meant to be that way. Didn't hit me. So what's the problem? There's no problem. It's like that. I just say, hey, it's just the Holy Spirit's just helping me out here. Thank you. Thank you. I actually thankful. It's another asteroid reference here. Come on. Thank you. Now, as far as that goes, the symbology was that this whole talk about asteroids heated up in 216. On the 16th fairway, okay, 16th hole. The topic was broached in 15, on the 15th hole. The 16th is when it really got intense, talked about it. And that's where I saw the bighorn sheep on the 16th. That's where I left my ball and said, I've had enough, I'm out of here. That's also where the sheep, while I was taping these bighorn sheep that were, you know, 10 feet or less away from me, four of them. I was just sitting in the golf where I was wide open to them, you know, and they were just kind of, you know, looking at me in a very friendly way, like, oh, what is this? Oh, well, it's not bothering us. Munch, munch, crunch, 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 eating the grass. Suddenly, I heard these rocks falling right at my back, right on my back. These rocks were falling. And I said, oh, my God, what's happening? What's happening? But I didn't stop taping. I didn't turn around, nothing. I just stayed taping. And gradually, it dawned upon me that there were two bighorn sheep at my back who were climbing this kind of cliff-like area and knocking rocks down right behind me. I said, oh my gosh, am I going to get hit by these rocks? But I still kept taping. I didn't turn around. And finally I finished. Then I turned around and there was these two bighorn sheep who were decided, oh, he's in our way. We're not going to come down. So they were kind of climbing back up the rocks, and they were, in doing so, they were dislodged, and the rocks, you know, came falling down again right on the 16th hole. So, the symbology of it would indicate something in 216. I've said, the Holy Spirit's told me that we have to be ready by the end of June of 216, ready for something. Maybe to shift into a higher realm. I would assume that's what it's getting at. So this is intense preparation, very serious intense preparation for that. Very intense, serious preparation. And so the symbology of these rocks falling, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So much symbology. And talking about the asteroid, 16th, on the 16th fairway, fixed 16th hole of this golf course. Kind of hard to overlook that, you know, that we're headed for 216 right now. And the Holy Spirit has told me, got to be ready by June of 216. Don't, you know, this is a very important time. Let's be ready before July of 216. Be ready before July of 216. Troubles are brewing for that, from that time onward, really. Don't want to be worldly, believing in help and learning. By that time, we must be free of this delusion that we have needs, free of the belief in the necessity of needs. We don't, it's not necessary that we believe in needs. We believe that God created us as we need as some necessity to have these needs. That's not true at all. We made it all up. God never created any of creation with being to be needy. There are no needs in reality. So there's no necessity to believe we have needs at all. We have to be familiar with this. Okay, it's very important. There is trouble coming. The Holy Spirit just kept pointing it out to me in the most intense way imaginable. It's just like, wow. Couldn't stop. I said, okay, it's enough. And it kept coming and coming and coming. Stayed away from the news. Stayed away from sports. Stayed away from everything. As a matter of fact, it was like the world didn't exist on this trip. Didn't exist. What world? All the stuff that's happening in the world, we never thought about it at all. No television. I said, no TV here in the room, no TV here. Well, actually, in the dining, the lounge area where we dine one place and the other area we dine, it's sort of casual dining. They have televisions, both inside, outside. Well, guess what was on? The entire time, all these TVs, all they had on the whole time, and in the golf pro shop too, what was it? Football. I just ignored it, completely ignored it. Even on our final dinner, it was a high dining place. We were in the lounge, which they had all the TVs all over the place, flat screens everywhere, and they're all on Monday Night Football. And the diners were watching and said, and cheering and stuff like that. We just paid no attention to it whatsoever. I mean, football is the religion of the United States of America. I'm telling you, this is extraordinary. Everywhere we went, it was just football. People are obsessed with football. And I said, you know, we don't need football on all these television screens. We need Jesus on all these television screens right now. And I'm not joking. I'm absolutely serious about that. And as I took all this video, I said, why can't they just put Jesus on these television screens? Because this is what we need. We need to get used to the shift into the death-free realm. Because this realm here, it seems to be, the Holy Spirit says, it's going to get clobbered. Because the whole purpose of this dream is imperilment. That's the purpose. So, you know, we would call this only natural that we get clobbered. Well, of course, because that's the whole purpose of this dream, is to try to, through imperilment, produce this new will, you know, some sort of extra will that God did not create, some sort of extra will that we can use to create a new will, to be the prime creator of a new creation. Imperilment is how we're trying to do this. So of course there's going to be imperilment here. There always is here. Historically, this is what my playing partner is saying. Yeah. It's throughout, go back through history. We were noticing the rocks and the cliffs and the lines, and I said, and I looked at it, I saw it first. I didn't say anything. I said, that's an ancient seabed was at this point, some point. And he then later on pointed out, I said, I think that line, you see that? I think that's the seabed. I said, yeah, I saw that too. I think that's exactly right. He said, this whole area was covered with an ocean. It was all ocean. And then we started talking about all the changes that have happened throughout history. He said, it's just on and on and on and on. He talked about the whole world was on fire at some point, which they're finding out that's true. Well, when an asteroid hits the ocean, many people think that it goes in the ocean, plop, and that's all the end to it. No, the speed of these asteroids are like 12 miles an hour or more. And the mass, I mean, 12 miles a second. Is it a second or a minute? Not an hour, I'm sorry. 12 miles per second, I think. Yeah, 12 miles per second. In 1 second, they're going 12 miles. Okay, so they go into the ocean. How deep is the ocean? I think that the deepest part, Mariana Trench, is about, what, 3.5 miles, 4 miles deep? That's it. 4 miles. Well, the asteroid's going 12 miles in 1 second. So It doesn't take much for this asteroid to go through that water and hit the bottom of the ocean. It hit in half a second. In less than half a second, it hits the ocean. That's how quick it is. And it just pushes all this water aside and you know, instantly vaporizes and the steam of the heat, and then it produces this tremendous crater in the bottom of the ocean, which opens up areas of the Earth which are much hotter, super hot. And the water coming back in hits this extreme heat of the whole thing and creates massive steam explosions, which may be bigger than the asteroid explosion itself. I mean, there's all these domino effect of effects, actually. The asteroid hitting the ocean creates this domino effect. They're starting to understand this now. I think they're getting accurate about it, getting closer to being accurate about it. And creates a massive acid rain, which kills off the all the ocean, the near surface of marine creatures, which has to do with the carbon and oxygen cycle here in the world, etc., etc., etc. Very, very bad such thing. So, you know, we're thinking, oh, well, the water will act as a barrier, you know, it goes in the ocean and it slows it down, stops, and that's it. Not the case. Not the case at all. So, asteroids hitting the world really do create this a severe imperilment of all the life forms on this planet, the whole ecosystem. Now, the world manages to bounce back, and I mean, nature bounces back from it. It always seems to find a way, right? I mean, there have been die-offs before, 90%, you know, so yeah, or more. Certainly, the acid rain. All, but what I was saying was, the fragments from the impact, even when it hits the ocean, the crater that is that's material gets thrown up into the atmosphere, and it and re-entering it heats up severely, heats up the infrared heat or some sort of heat that it sets the whole world on fire. Now, we're told, the Bible tells us that the destruction, final destruction, that the end times destruction will happen, is God will not, you know, quote unquote, God, this is a very bad way to say God, our dream of imperilment will imperil itself not through water like a flood, but through fire, that the whole world will be burned by fire, melted by fire. So this re-entering of the atmosphere, all the debris that's ejected, it literally sets everything on fire. A lot of stuff, which is very interesting. I'm talking to this man from British Columbia, this businessman, and he says they have a horrible drought up there. They haven't had snow in 4 years in Canada, up in that area. The ski resorts, they can't open. There's nothing, no snow. There's been a severe drought in Western Canada, and he said that they've lost entire forests, huge forest land. All gone, burned. This is terribly traumatic up there. And it could continue on because El Nino is supposed to cause severe dryness up there. I didn't know that. This has not been popularized in Canada. The drought in the western part of this continent is very severe. So he was talking about the massive burnings. I haven't paid attention to it. I've stopped watching the news, and I didn't. I for quite some time, I've really been minimizing my attention. So I did hear that there was this summer something. There's some awful fire, but it was just a brief mention, and I said I'm not paying any attention to that. So I really, the reaction. I've had no reaction to any of this stuff whatsoever. I have no reaction to whatever happened in Paris. I don't know what happened. I have no reaction to any of this stuff. I don't know what. I'm not paying attention to it. It's not important. We're out of here at some point. You know, death-free realm. Here we come. There's no imperilment. So why, since we're leaving the whole realm of imperilment, why pay attention to imperilment? It's really foolish. What evaluating that for what purpose? It doesn't serve any purpose. We've changed our purpose. Our purpose is to set this on our creativity, but set the whole purpose of that futility down. Why evaluate futility? This is a question. What purpose does it serve except an aimlessness? No reason to evaluate futility. all we do recognize futility, and that's the end of it. There's no valuation. We have to evaluate, well, which part of it is futile? Which part of futility is futile? This is what we're doing in this world. We're spending our time saying which part of futility is futile and thinking that we're getting smart by doing that. We're learning which part is futile. Why we're doing that? We're doing that to thinking we're going to discover some part of futility which isn't futile. This is why we're evaluating the world. And the fact is, there isn't any part of futility which isn't futile. So all this evaluating we're doing isn't necessary at all. It's just arrogance. It held in place by continuity fear. We don't need to evaluate the world. We don't need to evaluate futility. We don't need to evaluate learning. We don't need to evaluate impairment. It doesn't work. It's futile. It's all futile. So there's no value. There's no value. We keep thinking we're going to find value because we think there's some part of futility which isn't futile. So we keep assuming that we need time to find it. We need process. So we believe in that these are true. But really, we're just evaluating nothing at all. Hoping, believing that by a process of elimination, we'll find some part of futility which isn't futile. Will never happen. Will never happen, so it's useless. It's useless to do all this evaluating of this world. So I'm not evaluating impairment anymore. I don't care what happened in Paris. I don't care what forest fires. I don't care. In terms of value, has no value. I'm going to a realm where there's no impairment whatsoever. So why do I need to keep practicing reacting to fear? Why do I need to keep practicing reacting to fear? I don't need to keep practicing that. There's no impairment there in the deathly realm at all, so there won't be any reactions of, oh my gosh, oh yeah, you know, impairment, I can see. No reactions like that. And I said to the jaguar, you don't need to keep playing the role of impairment, you know, scaring people. You don't need to do that. And I believe there was a conscious, there was an experiencing in consciousness there. He said, the jaguar said, that's interesting. I kind of like this idea, you know. Why should I have to play the role of impairment? I'm tired of that. Scaring everyone, I'm imperiling you, you know. I'm imperiling, jaguar, my God. Of course, I don't recommend to anyone who's, you know, I don't, it, in this world, we believe in imperilment, that imperilment's all important, so of course we'll play the role of being imperiled here. So I don't recommend anyone out in the wild go up to a jaguar and say, hello, kitty, kitty. Let the sages do that. Let us not pretend we're sages when we're not yet. The sages are not bothered by tigers or jaguars or panthers or anything. Panthers will come up to them and sit down and say, "Hey, I like you. Yeah, I want to get some transmission of your presence here. I want to feel the presence of. I don't need to play the role of imperiling anyone." Yeah, they're not bothered by the wild animals at all. But I would not advise anybody to try and force the issue. Right? I wouldn't. If you ever find yourself in a difficult situation, say, "I am at home, fear is the stranger here. I am at home, fear is the stranger here. All of now is right now. All of now is right now. I am at home, fear is the stranger here." And don't react at all. Just say, I don't have a purpose of being imperiled. I no longer ask for any help at all. Because all help is really help in being imperiled, put in a perilous situation. This is the help we're really giving one another. Well, we're helping each other have bodies and keep bodies so we can keep experiencing imperilment, of course. Oh, I'm threatened by this illness. I'm threatened by this. I'm threatened by that. I had a safe trip home, driving home. Gotta be, but just driving on the road, you feel very much imperiled, right? This an art to it, driving in California, driving anywhere. And you just have to, heads up, on Interstate 5, because there's all these trucks in the slow lane, and it's a two-lane freeway most of the way. And so you got all these speeders who think they can get around everybody in the slow lane, and this is what they do. And then they speed up right on the tail of these big trucks, and then they jam their way back into the fast lane, causing the entire fast lane. One second, yeah.
Huh?
Leave you here. Come on. I have just
been. Okay. What do you need to do? Okay.
Well, imperilment. Somebody's in peril. They say, I need your help. Help, help, help. I'm in peril. I'm in peril. I'm in peril. So, there you go. Anyway. This is what I experience and live with. Fear. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here. Okay. Just say that. I'll try practicing that. Very great. I got to go at this time. I am at home. Fear is the stranger here.